Verse 36. Bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, as this message is brought forth, Lord, we ask you to open our hearts, open our minds. Lord, fill me with your spirit, that everything I speak would be your words. The message would be your message. It would be nothing about me, but all about you. And Lord, we just pray that we would open ourselves up to your guidance and your leadership in our lives. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Starting in verse 36. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee's home and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought also an alabaster jar of perfume. And as she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisees who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of a woman she is, that she is a sinner. And Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. Two men owed money to a certain money lender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back. So he canceled the debts of both. Now which of them will love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. Then he turned towards the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. The other guests began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. It's a beautiful story, one that many of us have heard before. We know the story. We know what went on in this story. But do we really stop to think about what the situation was? That here, Jesus Christ, the one they had talked about, the forgiver of sins, the one who makes us all equal at the foot of the cross, he had come to the house of this high and exalted Pharisee. This Pharisee who was a teacher of the law. The Pharisees were the ruling religious leaders of the time. And he had asked Jesus to come on over and have supper with him. While they are eating, word had evidently gone out where Jesus was. It seems that anytime Jesus did something or went somewhere, word went out ahead of it. And this woman, who was a sinner, Now, you can go a lot of places with that. But all the Bible says is this woman was a sinner, and she knew it. The Pharisee was taking his place. It was his house, so he would sit at the head. And he took his place at the table because he had had Jesus Christ come on over, and so he would sit up there with him to put himself on the same level of Jesus. But this woman came knowing she was a sinner. She knew who she was and what she was. Too often, once we've been members of a church for a while or got ourselves, you know, drug up and we think we're pretty good anymore, and so we start putting ourselves, just like this Pharisee did, looking at Jesus logically, looking at Jesus as just our friend, looking at Jesus on our level, through our eyes. And when someone comes along and they see Jesus as the Savior, as the only way of salvation, and they see themselves compared to Jesus, they see the sin in their life, and they see truly what Jesus came to do. Too often we like to puff ourselves up and raise ourselves up and look around at others in this world and feel sorry for them, feel that they really need to do something with their lives. But we don't ever really feel that love in our heart that Jesus gave us to reach out with the love of Jesus. Now, this woman comes in there. I gotta be honest. I have never in my life seen anybody come in and cry on somebody's feet. I mean, that's kind of a strange thing. We would really think that's kind of strange if somebody came on in to our house. First thing, if we had an uninvited guest come in nowadays, we wouldn't be very open to it. You know, most generally we like our lives a little structured. We don't like people just to come in, especially some sinner come into our life or into our midst. You know, some lady who is a sinner come on into our family and come into our presence. But let alone to come in and start crying on one of your guest's feet, it just seems a little strange to me. Seems a little odd. But the sad part is that would be because of the lack that I have, not because of the lack she has. She sees Jesus for what he is. She sees her for who she is. Do we really see ourselves for who we are? We are sinners saved by grace. Every one of us here deserves to spend all eternity in hell. You might look around and you see some nice people. There's some good people here. I've known some of them for a long time. Others I haven't known as long. But usually when I look at somebody, I don't think, boy, they sure deserve hell. But the Bible says
We all deserve to spend eternity in hell. We are all sinners saved by grace. But we have come to a point in our lives where we live our lives more like Jesus and God are our best buddy rather than our Creator and our Savior. And we want our life to be centered around us, not centered around Him. I'm sure this lady had many other things to do in life. She had many things she could have done. If I ran into Jesus Christ today, would I be humble enough to get down on my knees and wipe his feet, clean his feet? Or would that be below my status? Would that be below my attitude? Would it be below your attitude to get down on your knees, take your hair and wipe the feet of Jesus? Sad to say, I think most of us would really hesitate to do it. We think too much of ourselves. And we don't think about enough about what God has given us. If it was not for Jesus Christ, each and every one of us would spend all eternity in torment and in hell. That's what God's Word says. If it hadn't been for Jesus Christ, look at these beautiful kids, you know, the new little baby. Everybody in your family, there would be no hope for any of them. Each of these children would spend eternity in hell. Your mother, your father, your grandparents, your grandchildren. But we never stop to think about that. We're too busy with the world. We're too busy with our lives. This Pharisee was too busy with religious things. He was too busy with entertainment to realize who he really had sitting at the table. And it took a lady who was willing to get down. You realize how low you have to get to wipe the feet of somebody with your hair? But she was willing to do it. She was willing to admit who she was. It's interesting here at the end, though, that Jesus says to her, your sins have been forgiven. He didn't say that to Simon. He didn't say, Simon, your sins have been forgiven. But he did to the lady who realized who she was and what she was. Where would you put yourself in the story that Jesus told? Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. You know, we can put that into American dollars. You know, if somebody owed you $1 million and somebody else owed you $5, which are you more apt to forgive? $1 million loan or the $5 loan? Well, maybe most of us wouldn't always like to lend $1 million anyway. So, $10,000, we'll really, that'd be maybe a little close. Would you lend $10,000 to somebody and then forgive them for that loan? $5, yes, maybe, but not $10,000. We're not going to forgive a loan like that. But yet Jesus does. And it says, and he asked Simon, which which of these feel more apt to be touched more? See, how's he word that? So he canceled the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more? He puts it down to love. Who's going to love him more? And it says, Simon answered, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled. Okay, are our debts that much different? They're really not. The difference between Simon and this woman wasn't that Simon didn't have much sin, and the woman just had great sin. The difference was Simon didn't see his sin. He didn't think he was that bad of a person. The woman knew what she was. It's kind of interesting because as this reads, it never says what the woman was, except for a sinner. Maybe it was just some lady that told a lie. We don't know, but we all know where our minds went when we first read it, didn't we? We all thought she's a lady of the evening. That's the first place you go. Well, she's a great sinner, must be a lady of the evening. No. Might have been a housewife. She was just frustrated with the way her husband treated her, tired because she had six kids. And she couldn't control her temper. She couldn't control herself. She didn't tell her kids about Jesus. She didn't put Christ first in her life. We don't know what her sin was. None of us know. But we're quick to judge. But Jesus saw that she was willing, no matter what her sin was, to realize compared to Jesus, none of us should be up at the table. We should all be down on the ground, begging for mercy. Because none of us deserve salvation. There is nobody in this auditorium who deserves salvation. That salvation was a free gift from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God Himself became man. He created you. He didn't have to save you. He could have looked at you and said, you know what? I'm tired of the way you treated me. Because here I did all these things for you. I created you. I gave you breath. And I am just not really interested in having anything to do with you anymore. Spend eternity in hell. And that's what we all deserve. We're all separated from God by our sin. But instead, He loved you so much that He went to the cross for you, for your sins, for my sins, for this lady's sins, and for the sins of Simon too. He went to that cross and suffered death by crucifixion. But He also suffered separation from God the Father for your sins. God the Father had to turn His back on Christ the Son because God couldn't be around sin. And Jesus became your sin to take it to the cross so that you could spend all eternity with Him. That was His choice. That wasn't your choice. That was His choice. And how do you come to Jesus? come to them in a puffed up attitude of, well, you know, I really never did anything that bad. You know, I haven't killed anybody, I haven't, you know, I've only broken a couple of the Ten Commandments. You know. But every one of us should be coming to Jesus. Down on our face to wipe his feet with our tears. Why do you think she was crying? Do you think she was crying for herself? Or do you think she was crying for joy? I don't know. I think probably some of both. Crying because of what she had done to Jesus Christ. When's the last time you have cried because of your sin? When is the last time? Most of us could probably come pretty close. If I said, what were some of the sins you committed this week? Most of us could tell. Is there anybody that cried this week because of the sins that you've done? Did you just brush them off with a puffed up attitude? Because, oh, well, we're saved. Jesus is, you know, Jesus forgave us, and we can just go on living our own lives. We can do whatever we want to do and not worry about what the Savior is thinking. Every one of us does it at times. Let's be honest. But our sins breaks Jesus' heart every time we sin. It says he lives in the heart of believers. If you are a believer, you have Jesus Christ living in your heart. All this last week, take a second and think about what you've done. Because you have taken Jesus Christ in your heart all week long with you. Are you proud of that? We shouldn't be. We should be proud Jesus is in our heart. Don't get me wrong on that part. But are you proud about the life you have led this last week? Are you proud about the things you have said? Are you proud about the thoughts you have thought with Jesus in your heart? It is not a thing to be taken lightly. Our sin is never to be taken lightly. Think of the punishment for it. The punishment for any sin is eternity in hell. That's pretty graphic. That's pretty powerful. You know, my kids have broken rules before. But there's never been a time where I wanted any of them to spend eternity in hell. But that is our punishment for any sin. It's total separation from God. But yet we treat it so lightly. We treat it like it doesn't matter. God's calling us to do something and we just put it off. We find 20 reasons not to do it. God loves you. He died for you. He did that so that we would live for him. Not just live for us. Not live to satisfy ourselves. But to live for Jesus. The good news of this is that when we become repentant, when we get down on our face, when we are broken from our sins, when we truly feel horrified that we have hurt the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, humble about it. said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." If we have that attitude as Simon, you just shrug off the sin. We don't have that much sin. You just shrug it off. We're pretty good people. Hey, nobody's perfect. I can go ahead and hang on my own way, do my own thing. And nobody's going to make it perfectly through this life. And we just have that nonchalant, casual attitude about sin. And we want to live our own life. Then it's not good. Because it says right here, Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." That woman left there, forgiven of her sins, with peace in her heart, because of faith she had in Jesus. What was that faith? That faith was she knew who Jesus was. She was down on her face, wiping her tears off the Savior's feet. And she was forgiven. How many times do we just say, "Well, Lord, forgive me for what I've ever done today. If I did something wrong today, Lord, just forgive me for it." And then we're on for the next day. Rubber coat stamp that one. You know, God loves each and every one of us. His death and resurrection was for you personally. You might have already accepted him as your Lord and Savior, but down through the years, you've just started to have a casual attitude about it. You've got away from that passionate serving of Jesus Christ. And he calls each and every one of us back to that daily. We're to be passionate daily about it. We need to, because he has called us to be. Let's all bow our heads. Micah, you want to just turn on some soft music in the background? We're going to take a few minutes just to lift up to the Lord whatever you need to lift up to him this morning. And then I'll close this with prayer. Bow your heads.
Still there, oh, pray, oh, God. Help us to live like it. Help us to be moved every day by you.